Thank you, Jesus. Oh, Jesus, thank you, Lord. We just want to say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
You sing thank you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We love you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, we love you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You give life. You bring light to the darkness.
raise my eyes to fix my gaze on you. For your throne resides in the heavens. Just as the eyes of the servants closely watch the hand of their masters. Just as a maid carefully observes the slightest gesture of her mistress. In the same way we look to you, Eternal One, waiting for God, our God, to pour out his mercy upon us. O Eternal One, show us your mercy.
we do give you the glory. Everything that we can this morning, we say, be glorified, Jesus. The one most high, name greater than any other name. We honor you, Jesus. You're the reason that we're here. We love you so much. Thank you, Jesus. If you'd like to have a seat, we're going to take up an offering. Thank you that you go before us. Anything that we've yet to face, you've already faced. It's true. Any battle that we have to fight, you fought before, you've already won. I pray that we can give from that place. We're just full of gratitude. And I thank you for this money. In the name of Jesus.
There's a table that you prepared. would blossom like a flower in the desert. But for now, just let me cry.
And the only one who can bind up these broken wings, who can take this shattered world and put it back together again. We honor you this morning, God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. This morning we are we're finishing the book of Psalms. I know for me, Psalms in the Key of Life has been a crazy journey. I know as I've studied the Psalms, so many of them, I'll never read them the same as I used to read them.
Right.
I never will. There's so much richness in the text, and even in the midst of the repetition that we find, something I'm learning about repetition in the scripture is that God repeats himself because we need to hear it again. God encourages us to listen to him speak again and again in order for us to somehow begin to understand what he is saying to us. So this journey through the book of Psalms, has the psalmists have invited us into the depths of their pain. The psalmists have invited us into the passion that they have for God. The psalmist has invited us to hear his struggles that we all face, struggles with his sin, struggles with the enemy. We hear the psalmist desiring that God would punish his enemies, and what is called an imprecatory psalm, where the psalmist is saying, God, smash the teeth of my enemy. And we look at that and we're like, wow. Yeah, that's real life. That's where some of us are today. We've seen David lamenting over the pain of Israel's disobedience, over the pain of his own disobedience. We have heard the psalmist cry out, trusting God, putting his hope in God's faithfulness, even when we are unfaithful to him. I believe that is why we call it Psalms in the Key of Life. Because in many ways, the Psalms represent us, all of us on our journey. I can read a psalm one day and it's like, wow, that's right where I am. I read a psalm another day and I'm like, wow, that's right where Tim is. Right? The psalms resemble our crazy life, a life that is full of ups and downs, a life that is full of disappointment and celebration, a life that is full of highs and lows. The psalms speak to us right where we live. So after we prayed about it, and I went ahead and read the final 30 chapters of Psalms, I decided that we will finish the series today. As I read further, I began to see that much like Psalm 119, there appears to be some powerful affirmations throughout these 30 Psalms that just glare at us. So in order to maximize our time together, we're going to use kind of a broad stroke here
And we're going to listen to David once again as he allows us into his intimacy, his prayer life, his praise life with his God. And we hear his voice instructing us, encouraging us to be people of prayer, encouraging us to be people who know how to praise God, to be people who understand that all of those dynamics within the life of a believer are there to prepare us for what comes in life before us. Now, we know that the Psalms were not written in chronological order, but I believe within these final chapters, there are three overarching themes, and they are, God, show me how to pray. How many of us know that prayer is, it's crucial? If you're not spending time in prayer, you're missing out on one of the fundamental elements that should be a part of every Christian's life. When you wake up, when you rise up, your first word should not be, man, I hate this day. Ah, right, it's Monday. Ah.
Coffee.
Well, that can be in there somewhere, coffee. It should be, God, thank you for another day. Start right away. That we would learn that these elements need to be a part of our lives because they prepare us. You hear me what I'm saying? They prepare us to persevere through the challenges and the changes that are going to come into your life. Nobody knows what tomorrow morning holds. You could wake up and your whole world could be just totally off kilter. If you have a life that is based on spending time with God and prayer and praise and thanksgiving and all those things that are a part of that, you will be prepared for whatever lies ahead of you. Many of the next 30 Psalms are actually songs that David wrote for the Israelites while they were on a journey to worship in Jerusalem. This was a treacherous journey that God's people took as they were searching for the sacred. This is the journey that they took as they were longing for wholeness in their life. This was a journey that they took in order to find the peace of God. The Voice commentary says, for centuries, God's faithful people of the first and second covenants have gone on pilgrimages to the Holy Land and Jerusalem. Often these songs have gone with them, for they desire to draw close to God and to walk in his steps, in the steps of those who have passed the faith along to them. So the psalmist is passing this message to us. So as we begin this morning, we hear David, the man after God's own heart, a man who lived a life, first of all, full of praise. In fact, praise is mentioned over 175 times in the Psalms itself, in these Psalms itself. And it's like these final chapters of the Psalms, David is crying out and he's praising God. He's finishing strong. He's finishing with his eyes toward heaven, with his hands outstretched. And he's praising God. And the first thing that we see in these Psalms is that he has a passion to praise God with his whole heart. Praising God with a whole heart. Not a half heart, not a three-fourths heart, but a whole heart. Well, David had issues. We know that, right? David had struggles. Everybody knows that. The man did one thing well. He knew how to praise God with his whole heart. No matter what. Again and again. We hear him saying things like this in Psalm 134. Oh, praise the Lord, all you servants of the Lord who serve at night in the house of the Lord. Lift up your hands toward the sanctuary and praise the Lord. In 135, he says, praise the Lord, praise the name of the Lord, praise you who serve the Lord, you who serve in the house of the Lord, in the courts of the house of our God. Praise the Lord, for the Lord is good. Celebrate his lovely name with music. We did that this morning. It was an extended time, and it was done on purpose. Because this was a passion of David's, and it carried him through those times when he felt like his hands were weary, and he couldn't say a word. He knew how to praise. Praise wasn't something that David had to work up, as we saw earlier in this series. David was full of it. He was full of praise. Praises were always on his lips. It was a part of who he was. And not just him, but David declared that the priest, the descendants of Aaron, the Levites, all who fear the Lord, the ones who serve at night, the ones who come in the morning, the ones who stay in the afternoon, he says, you need to praise the Lord. Again, he says, O Israel, praise the Lord. O priests, descendants of Aaron, praise the Lord. Levites, Levi, where you at? Praise the Lord. Right? All who fear the Lord. Anybody here fear the Lord? What are we to do? Praise the Lord. Lord, be praised from Zion, for he lives here in Jerusalem. Praise the Lord. Do you get the message? Throughout these final psalms, David focuses on praise. In fact, Psalm 144 through 150 begin. They all begin with the words, praise the Lord. Praise him with your whole heart. Next, David tells us how important it is for us to praise God with a grateful heart. With a grateful heart. So many of us can't say that we have a grateful heart, can we? Because mostly we complain and whine, as we talked about last week. And as I was reminded all the time when it was raining, that I shouldn't whine, but I should praise him. So I was at Sam's Club this week in Greensboro, and it was everyone's intention that day to ruin my day. Every other driver, every person in that store woke up that morning saying, we are going to ruin Ed's day. That's what it felt like. Everybody backing out in front of me, everybody cutting me off, everybody stopping in the middle of the road where you're supposed to kind of drive by, and they just kind of park and turn their flashers on and then go in the store. It's not a parking spot. It's a drop-off. And so as I was unloading our stuff off the cart into the van, I heard this little voice in my head whose name is Jesus. He said, are you praising him seven times a day right now? And I said, no, I'm not, but I will. And I started praising him. I started praying for all these people who were super annoying me right now. And I started saying, God, help them. Who knows what they're going through? Who knows the pain that they're facing right now? Help me to stop judging them and to love them, because I may be the only Jesus they meet today. And help me stop staring at them with stink eye and look at them with loving eyes. I need to learn to have a grateful heart. I mean, usually we do anything but act grateful. Yet with a grateful heart, David says, give thanks to the Lord. For he is good. His faithful love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord, to the God of gods. His faithful love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. His faithful love endures forever. David repeats this phrase again and again and again and again. I've had people say, Pastor Ed, why do we sing songs and sing them again and again and again and again? Because I believe the psalmist set the pattern for us. We don't need to repeat ourselves because God's forgetful. We need to repeat ourselves because we are forgetful. He says he was faithful forever, and his love endures. David goes on, he says, I give you thanks, O Lord, with all my heart. I will sing your praise before the gods. I will bow before your holy temple as I worship. I praise your name for your unfailing love and faithfulness, and for your promises are backed by all your honor of your name. As soon as I praise, you answer me. You encourage me by giving me strength. Got a call this day from one of my sons and said, I've started doing this, Dad. It's a crazy thing. It works.
Yes.
It's like work was going crazy this morning, and I just kind of stopped and started praising God. It works. I'm like, duh. I did it at Sam's Club. It works. Changes the way you think. It changes your attitude. You see, David begins to see God for all that he is. And although he knew God because of his sin, he knew that God was a God of justice. He knew that God would deal with us. He would deal with his sin. And he knew that he had to come before this righteous, holy God. He also was able to declare that the Lord is merciful and compassionate. That's good news today. In case you didn't know, now you know. The Lord is merciful and compassionate in Psalm 145. He's slow to get angry. I am so glad. Because I'm sure I test that every day. And he's filled with unfailing love. The Lord is good to everyone. He showers compassion on all his creation. All of your works will thank you, Lord. And your faithful followers will praise you. They will speak of the glory of your kingdom. Next, we also see something that we've seen before about David, is that he shows us how to praise God with a desperate heart. Desperate heart. In Psalm 120, he says, I took my troubles to the Lord. That's a mouthful right there, isn't it? We usually take our troubles somewhere else. David says, I took them to the Lord. I cried out to him and he answered my prayer. He rescued me, O Lord. Rescue me from liars and from all the deceitful people. You see, in desperate times, David knew that his faithful God was faithful. And that we also see him as a God that we can call on in the good times as well as the bad times, in our troubles and when all the world is right. In another psalm, David says, I look up to the mountains. Does my help come from there? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let you stumble. The one who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel never slumbers or sleeps. The Lord himself watches over you. The Lord stands beside you as your protective shade. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon at night. The Lord keeps you from all harm. He watches over your life. The Lord keeps watch over you as you come and as you go, both now and forever. Man, that's great. And he's the same God that David cried out to, because he never changes. He's still faithful like that. Our hope comes from him. It doesn't come from anywhere else. Ancient Greek physician Hippocrates was attributed with the phrase, desperate times require desperate measures. Now, he didn't actually say it that way, but that's the way it was translated. And while most of us would agree, David would say that desperate times require desperation for God. Desperate times require desperation for God. He said in Psalm 145, the Lord is close to all who call on him. Yes, to all who call on him in truth. Very important. That he grants the desires of those who fear him. He hears their cries for help and he rescues them. The Lord protects all those who love him, but he destroys the wicked. While David knew that desperation, what desperation felt like, he also knew that God was just as faithful in the good times as he was in the desperate times. The next theme in these Psalms that David reminds us of the power of prayer, our need for prayer, the need for prayer in every believer. He shows us, first of all, that we need to learn to pray with persistence. I believe we give up too soon, don't we? We give up. We pray for a while, and then we kind of throw our hands up and say, well, I guess it's a busy signal. I guess the internet's down in heaven. He's not catching my emails. Or when you call him, he just muted your call on his phone, right?
Yeah.
Like you would never do that to somebody.
Don't ignore me.
He never does that, does he? The psalmist refused to give in or to give up on God. He persevered through all the difficulty he faced. In Psalm 130, he says, "From the depths of despair, O Lord, I call for your help. Hear my cry, O Lord. Pay attention to my prayer. Lord, if you kept a record of our sins, who, O Lord, could ever survive?" I know I couldn't. But he says, "You offer forgiveness that we might learn to fear you. I am counting on the Lord. Yes, I am counting on him. I have put my hope in his word. I long for the Lord more than centuries long for the dawn." Yes, more than centuries long for the dawn. David refused to quit. He refused to give up on God. When he felt God was calling them or speaking to him, he brought it to God over and over and over again. In Psalm 132, he says, "Lord, remember David and all that he suffered." He made a solemn promise to the Lord. He vowed to the mighty one of Israel. David says, "I will not go home. I will not let myself rest. I will not let my eyes sleep, nor my close my eyelids in slumber until I find a place to build a house for the Lord, a sanctuary for the mighty one of Israel." David didn't quit. It was as if he knew and he was committed to trusting God. And it showed in his prayer life as he vowed to the Lord that he will not rest. He will not give up. He will not let his eyes close, or nor will he sleep until the Lord shows up and shows him where the temple is to be built. That's persistence. We give up too early, don't we, Brian? We do. Next, we see that David knew how to pray with passion. He knew how to pray with passion. Listen to the passion in David's prayers. "Oh Lord, I am calling on you. Please hurry." I've said that a time or two. Have you?
Yeah.
"Please hurry, God. Listen when I cry to you for help. Accept my prayer as incense offered to you and my upraised hand as an evening offering. Take control of what I say, O Lord. Guard my lips. Ooh. Don't let me drift toward evil or take part in the acts of wickedness. Don't let me share in the delicacies of those who do wrong. I cry out to the Lord. I plead for the Lord's mercy. Pour out my complaints before him and tell him all my troubles. Hear my prayer, O Lord. Listen to my plea. Answer me because you are faithful and righteous. I lift my hands to you in prayer. I thirst for you as parched land thirsts for rain." Something we have no clue about here in North Carolina. But we've seen days like that. We've all witnessed summers where it just went on and drought and drought. And you walk on the ground, it's crunchy. The grass is brown and brittle. Maybe that's where you are right now. You're like a dry and weary land where there is no moisture. You ever felt your heart like that? Pray with passion. Lastly, we hear David pray with penitence. David was great at praying. He was great at praising. But he also knew how to repent, didn't he? Full on repentance, man. Just read Psalm 51. Just read Psalm 51, man. He just laid it out for God. We've seen in David's life that although he may have found himself away from God, separated by his sin, David always seemed to find a road back. I think he left breadcrumbs. Something to show him how to get back. I love toward the end of Psalm 139, he says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me. Know my anxious thoughts. Point out anything in me that offends you. Is there anything about you that offends God?" Perhaps we could get the image that our entire life, everything that we do and everything that we say and everything that we think is on a jumbotron in heaven. And he's sitting there with popcorn, watching your life. Point out anything in me that offends you. Perhaps we need to be worried about offending God before we're worried about offending each other. Nobody wants to talk about that, do they? David says, "Lead me along the path of everlasting life." David knew how to pray with penitence. I believe David is reminding us that the way we pray and the way that we praise will lastly prepare us to fight our battles. We just sang it. It may look like I'm surrounded. It may feel like I'm surrounded by all of hell's devils, by every circumstance, every pain, every illness, every bit of depression, and whatever else you got going on in your life. But David understood that all of the praise and all of the prayer, all the time that he spent with God was there to prepare him for his battles. We've got to remember we are in a battle. It is life or death. David knew that when the people traveled to worship, there were multiple obstacles in their path. Many of them were robbed because they were bringing their offerings to the temple. So they were bringing gold and different things to give to the Lord. They were coming and going through the wilderness. And Pastor Tim and the folks, Hub and Judy and Chris and Melanie, they and Penny, they saw what it looked like in the desert, in the wilderness. And they said, one thing that Israel doesn't lack is rocks. And many of the trails that they took in order to get to Jerusalem were very treacherous. There were times where they would break limbs, where they would fall off of cliffs. Not only that, they had marauders who were going to steal from them. They were exposed to the sun during the day. And then at night, the temperatures would drop drastically. So they had all of these obstacles. And so David wrote these psalms for his people while they were on their way. Do you hear that? Because life is full of all kinds of distractions. It's full of all kinds of treacherous obstacles that can trip us, that can expose us, that can cause us to fall away, cause us to get injured to the point where we don't want to think or see God because life didn't turn out the way we hoped. And so these psalms and these times of praise and worship and prayer can be opportunities for God to give you hope when the journey is difficult. So David says, what if the Lord had not been on our side? Let all Israel repeat. Let all of us repeat. What if the Lord had not been on our side when people attacked us? They would have swallowed us alive in their burning anger, and the water would have engulfed us. The torrent would have overwhelmed us. So many of us have been there. We felt that point where you feel like the water is just right there at your nostrils, and you can't hold on any longer. David goes on, he says, the raging waters of their fury would have overwhelmed our very lives. Praise the Lord. Great time to praise the Lord, right? He did not let their teeth tear us apart. We escape like a bird from a hunter's trap. The trap is broken. Praise God, we're free. Our help is from the Lord, the same God who made the heavens and the earth. Again, he says in Psalm 138, though I am surrounded by troubles, you will protect me from the anger of my enemies. You reach out your hand and the powerful, your right hand saves me. The Lord will work out his plans for my life and for your faithful love, O Lord, endures forever. Don't abandon me, for you made me. And in order to prepare myself to fight battles, I need to pray. I need to praise God in times of trouble. And then he says that this prayer and this praise will also prepare us to face opposition. David was well aware that it was God and God alone who could save him from his enemies. I said to the Lord in chapter 140, I said to the Lord, you're my God. Listen, O Lord, to my cries for mercy. O sovereign Lord, the strong one who rescued me. You protected me on the day of my battle. Lord, do not let evil people have their way. Do not let their evil schemes succeed, or they will become proud. He goes on in verse 9, let my enemies be destroyed. This is imprecatory right here. Let my enemies be destroyed by the very evil they planned for me. Let burning coals fall down on their heads. There's a prayer. Let them be thrown into the fire or into the watery pits from which they can't escape. Don't let liars prosper here in your land, because great disasters to fall on the violent. Then he concludes, but I know the Lord will help those they persecute. He will give justice to the poor. Surely the righteous people are praising your name. The godly will live in your presence. Right here, right now, in the day and age in which we live here in the good old US of A, we don't experience the persecution that many of our brothers and sisters in other countries do. I don't know the rate at which Christians are slaughtered in this world, but I know it's incredible how many Christians are murdered in this world, and you just don't hear about it. But there may come a day. There may come a day when you and I have to fight for the gospel, to contend for the gospel. We hear this in Jude's message in verse 3. He says, beloved, while I was making every effort to write you about our common salvation, I was compelled to write to you urgently, appealing that you fight strenuously for the defense of the faith, which was once for all handed down to the saints. The faith that is the sum of Christian belief that was given verbally to believers. This is how we fight our battles. This is how we face opposition. It is by praising God. It is by spending time with Him, praying persistently, praying passionately, repenting of our sins, and coming to Him wholeheartedly. Thus, our life of prayer and praise will prepare us to follow wherever He leads us. David said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow. Whatever journey you have to walk down in the days to come, we are empowered to follow His lead as we spend time with Him. In Psalm 145, he says, let each generation tell its children of your mighty acts. Let them proclaim your power. He says, I will meditate on your majestic and glorious splendor and your wonderful miracles. Your awe-inspiring deeds will be on every tongue. I will proclaim your greatness. Everyone will share the story of your wonderful goodness. They will sing with joy about your righteousness. You see, David is showing us that the greatest way that you and I can follow his lead is by making sure that we pass that message, that we pass that love for God, our passion for him, to the next generation. Make sure they get it. The Israelites often would, when they rise up in the morning, they would quote the Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. They said it in the morning as they were getting the kids' lunch boxes ready. They said it along the road. They said it at night. Guess what began to happen to those little ones? What happens when you teach your children over and over again? After they're teenagers, they start getting it. Because repetition is powerful in our lives and in the life of the next generation. We cannot afford to let our kids and our grandkids forget who God is or what he's done. Are you hearing me this morning? That's on us. That's on us. This morning, as we conclude the Psalms, I invite Joy and Lisa to come up. As we conclude the Psalms in the Key of Life series, I want us to quiet ourselves before the Lord for a minute. In fact, I invite you to stand and just bow your heads. Perhaps this morning, we could end this series by listening to a prayer that David prayed at the very beginning of Psalm. He said, oh, the joys of those who do not follow the advice of the wicked or stand around with sinners or join in with mockers. But they delight in the law of the Lord, meditating on it day and night. For you, the Eternal's word is your happiness. It's your focus from dusk to dawn. You will be like a tree planted by flowing and cool streams of water that never run dry. It says your fruit ripens in its times. Your leaves never fade or curl in the summer sun. No matter what you do, life prospers. Your relationship with God will grow even when the sun is scorching your life. Even when you're afraid. Even when you're going through the battles. Because you have dug a deep well. Because your tree is planted by a stream that is flowing with clear, fresh, cool water. And in that place, your roots grow down deep into this, to the soil, drawing up nourishment. Perhaps this morning, you could get just a little glimpse of where God wants you to be with him. Father, thank you that you call us to this place today. Let us listen to what your Spirit is saying.
I would love.
Brave the wild.